So it's very important to note that Carnatic music is one of those brilliant melodic systems that are extremely complete in every aspect that you can imagine with respect to melody, whether in the variety of the incredible musical forms, right from Varanam to Kriti to Javali to Padam, Thillana, Kavadi Chindis and so forth, or to the complete forms of melodic improvisation, namely pure melodic improvisation by way of Raga Alapana, semi-melodic, semi-rhythmic improvisation like Thanam, or a mellow rhythmic improvisation like Kalpana Swarams, or a pure rhythmic improvisation like Taniya Artanam, or an improvisation where all these things are gelled by way of Naravel with also lyrics. So in this, what we are going to focus on now is the approach, concept and art of Alapana. Alapana as a concept dates back to many centuries. People have always been improvising based on the ragas, just humming phrases of the raga and so forth. There are a lot of technical, historical terms and development aspects related to this, which is going to be an assignment for all of you to go and study. I'm going to make this as simple as possible, and it's up to you to find out what are the parallel historic terms or Sanskrit terms or technical terms for those. So let's take what are the features of raga that one has to be thorough with even before setting out to improvise. Whether it's going to be Alapana or Swarams or Naravel or Thanam or compositions, certain aspects of the raga one has to know very thoroughly before embarking upon the raga. The important point to note here is also that unlike certain other systems like Western classical music or even jazz and other things, Carnatic music and Indian music as a whole is not so much centered on the composition. It's not like you learn different compositions and then know the composition by name. It's more about learning the raga. So the raga is the center. The composition is just one of the facets of expressing that raga. So similarly, if you take Alapana or Naravel or Thanam, the aspects of the raga is common to all these things for an artist to be thorough of. So what are the things that one needs to know about the raga before one even can start thinking of improvising? Number one, the scale of the raga. When I say scale, in Indian parlance, it refers to what possible melakarta that raga belongs to. So that is important as a primary rule for us to know what notes are in the raga. The second is the kramam, the sequence those notes are arranged in. So if you take, for example, Shankarabharanam in Kadana Kutuhalam or RFB, Nalina Kanti, all these things are still in the same scale, but their sequences are different. So there is a difference between scale and sequence. So there is a huge difference it makes melodically, something that has been beautifully explored in Indian system of ragas, of changing a small thing in the sequence but still bringing a different shade of that mood of that. Now, for example, if you take, say, Shankarabharanam, RFB, or, say, Kadana Kutuhala and all this, they are all still in the positive shade of cheer, brightness, happiness kind of things, but different shades of that. Whereas to a Westerner, it'll all sound like the major scale, the Shankarabharanam scale. So many times they may not be able to appreciate the nuances of the subtleties that are involved when you actually change the sequence. Sari ga ma pa da ni fa, sari ma da ni ga pa fa, sari ma pa da fa fa ni da pa ma he fa. So all these things are bright sounding, but there are shades. And that is like almost like visual shades when you actually look at so many different possible color combinations within that red or blue or green and so many shades of those colors. The same concept is beautifully explored in the Indian raga system. It's a very significant point that I have also been endeavoring to share with most of my Western collaborators or audiences. So that is an important thing to understand. What is the sequence? In a strictly Carnatic context, the sequence is very important for at least 95% to 98% of the ragas. Only a handful of ragas like Devagandhari, Edukula Kambodhi, Athana are actually going beyond the sequence. So what you see in Arohanam Avarohanam need not be the only way of the way the raga flows. In almost all other cases, a raga can still be rendered best when the integrity to sequence is maintained. You cannot take poetic licenses with the sequence in many of these ragas, even though some of the ragas have other important characteristics, which I'll be coming to shortly. So, scale, sequence. The third important thing to know is which are the type of gamakas used in that sequence. Now, if you take todi. Sari ga ma pa da ni sa ni da pa ma ga re fa. That's the scale. And the sequence is right. But if you don't have the correct gamakas, the oscillations, or the force, the sharpening or flattening of certain notes as required, all those things will be part of the movement of those notes, which is what gamaka itself translates to. So, sari ga ya, sari ga ma. Padani dayani sa sa ni da pa ma ga re sa. If you take this example itself, it's a very classic thing, because the amplitude of that oscillation of the ga and ni in todi is one of the highest. Sa re ga ya sa re ga. From it starts on the Shuddha Rishabham itself. Ga ya re to ma to Chaturshruti Rishabham. Then the range of the oscillation then becomes from ma to re two. So, but it still starts with re one. So because the range ultimately is from ma to re two, a lot of people confuse and they'll even start off from re two. Sa re ga ya ya, because of the tendency to oscillate it from there is very aesthetic as well. A lot of people do that. But really, you should really start it from sa re ga ya ya ga ma ni da ma ga re ga ma pa da ni da ni. So many types of oscillations. So an artist has to be aware of not only which notes are oscillated, but in what types, in what context. The next is how they are oscillated in ascent and descent. Sa ni da sa ni da pa. So the same thing when it's oscillated in fast speed will be different. You see the difference here is that ga is very graceful when done slowly, but it becomes forceful when it's done fast. Sari ga ma ga ma ga ma da da ma ga ma da da ni da da ma ga ma ni da ma ga ma da ma ga da da ni sari ga ya ya. So it's a very important point to note how that grace and force are balanced and how one changes into the other. It's almost an opposite quality, grace and force. So the same thing becomes opposite when you increase the speed or the tempo. So the next aspect is to know which notes are rendered slightly flat or sharp. Now if you take Gaya Ama in Kalyani or any of the ragas which are Pratimadhyamam, generally Pratimadhyamam Panchamam combination, the ma is always sharpened. Now, if you have pratimadhyamam without pa, then it will be rendered closer to itself. Ga ma da ma ga ga ma da ni da ma ya re ga ma. So ga ma pa ma. So the gravity of pa and sa.
Da ni fa da ni re.
Same principle applies there also. So this note is so similarly. Antara Gandharam sometimes is sharpened.
Ga ma pa.
In ragas like Nate,
Sari ga ma.
It's on ma almost. So these are the kind of subtleties that one has to be aware. And also why. What is the rationale of taking that note higher than what it is? Somebody might wonder why Carnatic music says ga 3 but renders it almost on ma 1. So the idea there is the force that is given to that note. The force is what propels it to the next note. So it's a very important thing to understand the dynamics of how the notes flow in Indian music and Carnatic music in particular. Then the other point to note is which notes can be elongated, which notes cannot be. Now if you take a raga like Devagandhari, so the da is elongated there with the oscillation. If you take Sahana,
Sa ni da ba ma,
will never get the raga there.
Sa ni da ba ma ga ma re ga re sa.
Elongating the wrong note can also kill the raga.
Sa ni da ba ma ga ma re.
If you do that, the raga is still dead. So you should be very aware of how not to elongate. The way a person sings Arohanam Arohanam itself will show how much that person has grasped the raga. That is why Arohanam Avarohanam is such an important barometer to be thorough about. The Murchana Kramam of that particular one. Which also includes like not only elongating the right note but also not elongating the wrong notes. A ni and ga in Arabi should never be elongated. It's almost like that. Never possible in Arabic. So, that's the next point. Another equally important point is which are the notes in which you can start a phrase or end a phrase. So, taking the same example of Arabic, you can do ending in re is fine. You can't end in
fani.
No.
Fani da. Teri fani da.
Will not be too bad but still not sound very great because it still sounds very unresolved.
Fani da.
Again, not that great.
Fani da ba ma.
No go.
Fani da ba ma ga.
Absolutely impossible.
Fani da ba ma ga re.
Sounds more fulfilling. So like that we have to see. Now coming back to the other thing, the reverse.
Ni da ba ma ga re,
no good.
Da ba ma ga re,
nice.
Pa ma ga re,
fine.
Ma ga re,
fine. Ga re, impossible. So like this, we have to be clear about which notes it sounds. And this means that an artist has to actually listen to a lot of great masters. Because much of this, if you are taking millions of phrases from which you can actually start and end a phrase in millions of notes, possibilities from which you can start and end a phrase in, nobody can actually learn it in a tabular form using an Excel spreadsheet or a computer program. Only listening will develop that instinct that we can start doing it ourselves. But the other thing to do is to sing it ourselves and see how it sounds to our own ears using the aesthetics of the raga, using the compositional aesthetics that we have imbibed when we learn kritis or varnams and other forms. We have to see how that raga is handled by the composer or by great musicians. So these things are very important. Now, equally important is key phrases of the raga. There are certain ragas which are dependent on certain phrases for them to come out. அப்படின்னு எடுத்த உடனே மொமெண்ட் யூ டேக் தட் யூ வில் கெட் சஹானா. யூ டோன்ட் நீட் டு சிங் த ஹோல் ஆரோகணம் அவரோகணம் டு கெட் த ராகாயன். First phrase will get you Atana. So like this, you have to know what are the key phrases and then what are good opening phrases for certain ragas. You can have like chess pieces, chess games actually. You can have more than one opening that still can get the raga nicely on the table. So you should know certain things, at least three or four good openings that raga actually finds appropriate, and we should hone in on those. And when we are developing a raga, we should also know what are good development notes, nyasaswaras as they call. So if you take a raga like Shankarabharanam, like that, the ga is a good place. My all will be fine, but you cannot be doing too much because there is the kind of different kinds of oscillation which will be coming in that note. So if you keep developing on an oscillated note, you cannot go too much. Take Kalyani for instance. You will tend to finish with that da. If you leave suspended, it don't sound as good. So these are all small things that we have to note. The subtle things of how to develop a raga is very, very important. So you should know what are the nyasaswaras. So if you take, say, Shankarabharanam, the good swaras will be pa, then hai sa, then hai ga. These are all very good notes to develop in. If you take, say, Bhairavi, the high ri is a very beautiful place. So like this, we should know which are appropriate notes to develop a raga in. Like this, we have to work on how to understand the raga first before we start setting out to do alapana. Now, let's take an example like, say, Riti Gaula and see how it goes.